In the era of chatbots, with every single company having a chatbot that can access user data, there's a lot of new attack surfaces. And I don't only mean AI-related attacks like prompt injection. It's even a lot of new regular web vulnerabilities that arise. It's especially dangerous when these chatbots can access critical user information, like the Azure HealthBot service that is created to answer questions of patients based on their medical history. A hunter called Yanir Tsarimi found a total of 4 bugs, allowing him to steal data of other users, for which he was awarded a total of $203,000. I will explain this video. Enjoy! Azure HealthBot is a service that can respond to customers' basic questions based on the medical database and based on their medical history. It was actually built pre-ChatGPT or pre-LLM era, so it was not everything based on the LLM. For example, you can control the flow of the conversation using just different expressions in JavaScript. And of course, this is meant to be used by hospital and medical facilities, so then the attack scenario you could think the attack scenario is only one hospital attacking another, but the truth is everyone can go to Azure website and create their own Azure HealthBot. So the attacker can do it as well. So the attack scenario of one tenant attacking data of another is very, very critical and can be very dangerous. But of course, developers were aware of this risk because, as I've told you, you can create your own JavaScript expressions to control the flow of the conversation, but to mitigate the risk of the JavaScript code just reading data of other users, this code runs in the isolated environment using the VM2 library. The way it works is it overrides a lot of built-in JavaScript functions and access to the prototype so that you cannot execute whatever code you want. For example, the require function, which is used to import modules, is overridden so that you cannot import any module. And this is robust, this is secure, but Microsoft wanted to change it slightly. They wanted to disallow importing most of the modules while still being able to import some of them. So they overridden the require function again, and this is the code that they used. At the first sight, it looks pretty secure. It checks if there is a whitelist of modules, and if there is, it checks if the currently imported module is on that whitelist. We don't have access to modify the whitelist, so there's not much we can do. There's only one function call to the index of function. Can you override the index of function? Well, actually you can. If you start developer tools right now, you can, using this code, you can override the index of function to do whatever you want. But the thing is, one of the main features of the VM2 library is to restrict the access to the prototype. So this would not work in the VM2 environment. But if you take a look at this code again, it's not the built-in index of function that was used, but instead is the index of function from the underscore library. And access to this is not restricted at all. So using this code, you could override the index of function to always return a number. So this check would always be true for any module, even those from outside this allow list, which allowed you to import any module, which then allowed you to execute arbitrary code, which you could use to steal data of other patients. And after Microsoft fixed this particular flaw, the hunter did not find a way to bypass this. He did not find a way to import modules from outside the allow list. So then he decided, okay, I cannot import any other modules, so let's see if I can do anything interesting with those that are allow listed. Because the way VM2 works is the code of those allow listed modules is run in the unisolated context, which means it's not restricted at all, which means you do not want to be running any user code there. Why does it work in this particular way? To be honest, I'm not sure, but maybe it was due to a lot of dependencies. If you wanted to run the module in the isolated context, you would also have to allow list all the dependencies of this module. Maybe it was something like this, I'm not sure, But it's also worth pointing out that the whole VM2 library, if you go to their NPM page, it says it's deprecated and it contains known sandbox escapes or isolation escapes or whatever you want to call it. And if you go to GitHub, you can literally see two escapes that were found in 2023 that are not fixed and that will not be fixed. So I'm quite interested, how did Microsoft deal with these? But coming back to our case, to the blog post by the hunter, he found that one of the import allow listed libraries was underscore, which is the same library he exploited in the first step. He found that the underscore library contains the template function, which just consumes a template, which can contain JavaScript code. So it's a pretty straightforward code execution. And as I've told you before, this code is run in the unisolated context, which means you can just read data of other tenants, read data of other patients, and send it to you. So it's another way to execute code. So Microsoft fixed this one as well, and the hunter no longer could import arbitrary modules. He also didn't find another way to execute code. So he decided to look at other ways to leak data, because after all, executing arbitrary code is not the only way to leak data. And he found that he can unsafely allocate a buffer. Because normally when you do this with a call like this, what happens is the buffer is zeroed out. The memory in the buffer is zeroed out, which means if you read it just after initialization, it's empty. It contains only zeros. But if you do exactly the same thing with the unsafe method to allocate the buffer, it's basically the same, just without the memory zeroing step, which means you are reading a random part of the memory with some data that was processed very recently by the server. And when he repeated this process a few times, he could find JWT tokens from internal Azure identity calls. He could find Kubernetes calls. He found data of customers of another hospitals and stuff like this. So even though it didn't allow him to execute code, he could read a lot of sensitive information in this way. And for the fourth one, which is, to be honest, my favorite of these four, we'll step a little bit back. We'll let go of the code execution functionality and we'll take a look at how did this bot fetch data of users. And this is the URL which would be sent to fetch this data. Importantly, three of these parts of the URL are static and two of them are parameters. One of these parameters is the tenant name, which would be the name of your tenant, and the other would be ID of the particular row that you want to fetch. And at this point, there was the authorization check if the tenant ID that's in the URL is your tenant ID or the tenant you're authorized to. If you try to put the name of another hospital here, another medical facility here, it would not work. If it was, the authorization check was good, it would proceed to make this underlying call. You wouldn't see this as a user, it would be somewhere on the backend, but this is the URL that would be constructed. And kudos to researcher for finding this out, because likely he could not see this, he could just guess it's what happens under the hood. And this is the URL that's Azure Table API call. And again, we have the tenant ID, and then we have the row ID, which was sent in the previous step. Then when this call is made, the user data is returned and the user data is then forwarded back to you, or back to your bot to be more precise. So now think what would happen if you send the request to a URL like this. The authorization check would still be okay because it's still the tenant parameter. It still points to your tenant, so you wouldn't be denied access to this. However, after this, in the second step, when the internal request would be sent, this is the URL that would be constructed. And this part would be cancelled due to the path traversal. So this URL would be equivalent to this one, which is a URL that fetches data of another customer. And then this response is sent back to you, thus giving you data of arbitrary tenant of Azure HealthBot. We do not know what were the exact bounties awarded for these four vulnerabilities, but we know that the total was $203,000. And that's it for today's video. If you've learned something new, leave a like. And if you want to watch another video about a path traversal, check out this one about my $20,000 path traversal in the Amazon S3 integration. For now, thank you for watching and goodbye.